Strip!
Fantastic.
When you got a strip, strip. Don't talk.
I think we need to talk about this in a minute.
We will do. Now, today we're looking at fake and substandard cables. Now, believe it or not, someone has sent us in these two beauties. Let's take a little look at one subtle difference between them.
Those conductors on the end there look a little silvery to me, Gordon.
They do. Well, we might have found a generous manufacturer, but I actually think these are aluminium. So I just took the side cutters and just scraped a little bit more of that copper colouring away. And there you can see that silvery material underneath, which I suspect is aluminium.
Okay, well, I'm still hoping it's silver, so we need a test cable. So we've got a cable here that's exactly the same length as the one we think is aluminium. We've shorted together the ends, and we're going to measure its resistance. So we've got 2 meters of conductor here that we're going to measure its resistance of. And if we get this as our test one, what would you expect to see on the second reading?
Well, hopefully we'll get a reference off the copper cable here. So I'm just bringing the tester there. And okay, so we've got 0.02 ohms.
Okay, so if the next cable we measure is aluminium, with the resistivity of aluminium being higher than that of copper, the resistance will also be higher, but I've still got a small hope that it could be silver and considerably less.
Well, that's Christmas sorted if we cash in the silver cable. Okay. Somehow I suspect, we don't have.
It's quite light, isn't it?
Yeah, flew into shot there. So again, let's just reconnect those leads up.
Okay, so when we press the button this time, we expect it to be higher. Press the right button, Gordon. It's the other one. Thank you. Okay, so, it's only just a little higher, Gordon.
I'd say that's 50% higher. So you may not think that makes much of a difference, but let's see what happens when we load it up. So built this across at the eFIXX Technical Centre. I threw a little bit of loft insulation under half the cable just to see what difference that makes. And then at the end, we've got a double socket loaded up with two kilowatt electric heaters. First time we've been warm in the unit for ages, so that might be making a reappearance.
So this should put it under some thermal constraints. So in other words, we're going to be measuring the temperature of the conductors as they rise up for the first 4 minutes. So we'll do the copper cable first. I think you've got the Mitrell thermal imaging camera there to bring in. So we're at 4 minutes, Gordon. So let's bring that in and see what temperature we're at.
Yeah, so just let's have a look at the cable just outside the insulation. So here we're getting sort of 28 degrees. Moving where half the cable's covered in insulation, you would expect it to get a little bit warmer.
Yeah.
So that's at 32 degrees.
So. Okay. So after 4 minutes, we're in about 32 degrees there in that thermal insulation. So we'll repeat the process by adding the 4 kilowatt load to the aluminium cable and see if that makes any difference. So we're off and running with that. We'll just give it a little while to get warmed up. So we'll go back in at 4 minutes. So we've got a fair test of the actual cable itself.
There we go, so it's getting up to 4 minutes. So I'm just going to bring back in the infrared camera. So again, we can see the cable, so it's already, you can see it's warmer than our copper equivalent. And then again, going to the insulation. And we're up at 36 degrees.
Okay.
So yeah. I think it's still rising, so I'll keep the timer running. So here we are at 7 minutes.
Pretty warm outside.
Yeah, so we're getting up towards 38 degrees, and then where we're half covered with insulation, we're up at 46 degrees.
Okay.
So now let's just see the equivalent of the copper cable back at 7 minutes as well, just to see what difference that makes us. Probably we're getting towards some sort of thermal stabilization. So the copper cable, and then again back in with the infrared camera, and there we go, so we're 30 degrees. And then back into the insulation area.
And it's a lot less, isn't it?
Sort of 36 on here, getting up to a 10 degrees difference. That's a third of a difference in the resistivity of the cable has made. So, that's not a great situation.
Okay.
Amazing, isn't it, really? I mean, let's think, you can actually get a cable that is copper clad aluminium.
Okay, yeah.
And that's fine, but possibly not when it's masquerading as pure copper cable and probably trying to charge somewhere similar to, but not quite the price you might have paid for proper copper cable.
And another little trick they can do as well is obviously not have quite as many strands in the one that's masquerading at the same cross-sectional area. So that's another little trick as well, Gordon.
Wow, so I have to count the number of individual strands on there and compare. Yeah, exactly. We have heard that on quite a few occasions that yeah, you might buy one reel and it's perfect, then on a possibly another shipment there's a strand missing. And you know, why would anyone really, I cannot understand why you'd want to do that. I mean, what's the difference between copper and aluminium?
Well, I would imagine in the pocket quite a lot, isn't it? So that brings us to that fake cable masquerading as a copper cable being aluminium, and it was considerably lighter as well,
yeah,
wasn't
and,
it?
And let's not forget, this was a real cable that was sent in that somebody found on site, so it was actually being used and was found to be in a dangerous condition. So watch out for fake cables.
We've got some twin and CPC or twin and earth cable in front of us here. This isn't fake. What would we suggest this one is?
We'd suggest this is substandard, and we're going to have a little look at some of the aspects that would make it substandard, but I think you found the first one, Gary.
Well, imagine we've rewired the property. Let's imagine it's a domestic dwelling. We've put all of this cable in. You're not going to know that there's an issue until you get to that second fix, the bit we all enjoy doing. Floorboards are up, chasing's been done, all the graft. And yeah, as I took my combination strippers here, I actually removed everything. So I was down to copper. So just show us yours. If I bring the hand camera in, show us the, how it should be done with that Doncaster cable.
So this is our, again, we like these strippers because they make life very easily. So we've got these on ideal. Check out the video we made on those.
Here goes.
Oh, there we go. That was easy.
Okay.
Pull our outer sheath off. Let's go back in for the inner conductors. Oh, that is nice and easy.
Okay, and this is the point when all that hard work's been done and we're second fixing. So I've got to brave myself for my moment. Okay, I'm going to show the strippers first. So let me bring myself in. So here we go. Let's go in with the strippers first. I'll just take a little bit off like you did.
You think we've done two operations in one?
Yeah, straight down to, you know, so you can easily then connect it into the electrical accessory. So obviously not acceptable. If I go old school, anyone?
Well, blame the tools, Gary. You know me, I like to blame the tools.
Well, just see it work perfectly. Let's go old school. Let's just take a knife, perhaps score round and see if I can get it off the old fashioned way. Yep. French chalk seems to be at a premium.
Gosh, that was easy. Most exertion I've seen you see all year, Gary.
Okay, right, again, just going to get this off now. Imagine being second fixing and faced with this. You know, it's all been plastered, floorboards are down. Wow, that is incredibly.
Come on, Gary, you're making it look hard.
Yeah, because it's easy. Oh, yes, there we go. So that's it, that's off, that's lovely. Yeah, I'm down to that one. Shall we bother with the second one?
Yeah, go on, go on.
Wow. So you can see straight away that it's not quite up to the standard of the cable you just stripped off. But I don't think the story's going to stop there with how difficult it is to strip gourd. No, that'll do. Okay, I'm ready to second fix now. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, can you imagine? Can you imagine getting to second fixing and finding your cable strips like that?
That's awful.
Would you have a choice? Would you take it back out, Gordon? Or would you have to sort of soldier on for that installation?
We used to think, what was the most expensive cable?
The one you didn't put in.
Yeah, well, in this case, the most expensive one could be the one you did put in that's substandard.
And possibly bought on price again. So if they've gone to no effort to make it easy to strip, I would suggest, what other corners might they have cut, Gordon?
The one we also hear is, check that cable reel has actually got 100 metres of cable on it, because that's one of the tolerances what we're talking about here, and we'll come back to that in a little while. But yeah, one of the easiest tolerances to save on is possibly not put 100 metres on the reel.
Plus or minus.
Yeah. Well, I'd suggest minus.
Okay. So okay, coming back to that in a moment. We've got a cable here. We've wound this out, and they are identical length. We did this off camera. And we're going to measure its resistance.
So we're going to compare our Doncaster cable that we trust. We've seen that cable being manufactured. We've seen the processes they go through to ensure consistent quality and those quality checks, because they make this stuff in, what was it, 10,000 meter reels we saw it being made in?
It just keeps going. You can't believe how much stuff there is. So if it's difficult to strip, have they cut back anywhere else? So let's start off with its resistance. I'd like to suggest it's at the identical ambient temperature and they're identical in length. And we'll have a go at measuring its resistance. Okay, so you get your leads ready there.
So what we've done here is we've connected At the end, we've connected the CPC to the line conductor.
Okay.
So we're just going to measure that at the...
And this one's a Doncaster one, isn't it?
Yep, so yep. I'm just going on the first one here.
Okay.
See if I can remember how to work the metrometer.
Okay.
So test.
They're ready to measure exactly the same conductor length and temperature. So what reading have we got here?
So the first one is 0.27 of an ohm.
Okay, so 0.27 of an ohm.
That's
okay.
Reference. Try and remember
so
that,
this is
Gary.
The substandard cable. Sorry, I apologise. Yeah.
So, yeah, swap it over. Do the same measurement again. You can tell it's... Oh,
yeah. Yeah, I know, there's a little bit... Yeah, so it's had a moment down there, so make sure don't...
So we're going to repeat the measurements. Remember, 0.27 going into this.
Yep.
Let's measure again. 0.3 of an ohm. Not a massive difference.
No.
No?
But a difference.
But a difference.
Yeah, and we played around with that in a couple of different ways to get the reading. When we did individual conductors, there was a difference. When we doubled the length, there was a difference, etc. So there is a difference in the resistance. So... What's that suggesting about the amount of copper maybe in it?
Suggest when again, when we're playing with that tolerance, we've decided just to thin that copper down a little bit, just to be able to stretch it out a bit further.
And when you're making hundreds of thousands of meters, that's going to make a big difference in perhaps your bottom line, isn't it?
Ton of copper, yeah, expensive stuff. So let's just, yeah, perhaps we'll have another look at that, Gary. Well, let's bring in our...
Measure it, are we?
Yeah, let's bring in the calipers.
Right, okay, so we'll have a little look at measuring this one.
It's reasonably accurate, so I can measure a fat finger there.
Okay, yeah, okay.
So I'll just check that being zeroed.
Yeah, okay. So we have a few attempts at this, don't we, until we get a reading.
Yeah, because obviously as we do it, it should be about 1.74, 75, 76.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Which is actually way around you'd expect it to be. Obviously, as we crunch it, it can get a bit thinner.
Right.
Let's check on our substandard cable. Oh, 1.64.
Yeah, that's what I got when I was practicing with it. Yeah.
1.65.
Somewhat thinner, I would suggest, Gordon. As you look at my drawing here of the good cable, I've taken some measurements. I took several measurements and come up with really an average of those measurements. See our dimensions there, about 1.76 millimeters for the diameter of the live conductor, CPC at 1.35. Overall diameter of the cable at 9.8 millimeters. But let's look at what we've suggested is the ugly cable.
Yeah, okay, so yes, it does seem to be under on all the measurements, so 1.65 millimetres and 1.28 for the CPC. So yeah, it's if you're going to save a bit of copper, you might as well be consistent about it.
So across all dimensions, we're a little bit smaller, but of course, when I go and get my 100 metre drummer cable, Gordon.
Well, there's another trick there, Gary, because what we've also found is to... If you're going to save a little bit of conductor diameter, you might as well just chop a little bit off the length as well.
We've heard a plus or minus number, haven't we, for some cable manufacturers, maybe plus or minus 3. Do they ever overshoot by 3?
Tends to be always underneath. So yeah, you might buy 100 metres and actually only end up with 97.
However, if you were to buy the Doncaster cable, the cross-reference cable we've been using today against this one we're calling the ugly cable, you actually are guaranteed 100 metres of cable.
That's it. Well, we've done all those tests, Gary, but we started with a thermal test.
Yes.
Perhaps let's just have a look if that just thin slither of copper that's missing does make any difference in the thermal performance.
Are you suggesting that the thinner cable may get hotter as well?
Let's have a look.
Let's have a look at that asset. So here we are then, Gordon. We've got our... Two heaters
straight in, so that's 4 kilowatts on there, nice and warm. Whoa, lovely at this time of year, just what we need.
I notice they're both pointing at you as well, so okay. So how long do you want to leave this on for?
So I thought we'd give this 10 minutes.
Okay.
So let's just to give it plenty of time, because obviously not as a severe situation as we had with our aluminium cable earlier.
Yeah.
You know, we're talking small differences between that resistance.
Right, yeah, so obviously the conductor size is slightly smaller. This is the Doncaster cable we're going to test first. So it'll be interesting to see what temperature the conductors rise up over that 10 minutes. So we expect it, don't we, as we measure between the two, there to be a difference. Not a huge difference, I wouldn't imagine, but there will be a difference as we build that temperature up in the cables. So 10 minutes it is, Gordon.
Yeah, getting nice and warm here. That's what we like. We'll have to do this test again.
I notice. Here we go. So we're in at 10 minutes. I'm
going to bring in the Metrel thermal imaging camera again. So we can see that's up at 34 degrees.
Okay, so 34 degrees after 10 minutes, and that was 4 kilowatts, did you say?
4 kilowatts on there. Yep.
Okay, so it'd be interesting to see when we move across to the second cable, what sort of temperature that is. So knock those off, and let's move it across to what we're calling the ugly cable next. So that one's heating up nicely now. So 10 minutes, Gordon, yeah?
Yeah, 10 minutes again. The 4 minute mark, we haven't got any flames or anything. We're not expecting a massive difference, but just a subtle difference between them.
Yeah, there's been subtle differences all the way, so it should be slightly hotter, I would suggest. So here we go, 10 minutes. You said 34 degrees on the Doncaster cable?
Yeah, 34, and this time we're sort of getting up towards 38 degrees. So yeah, sort of 4 degree temperature rise between them.
Yeah, so I don't wanna, so if you're gonna take a little bit off here and a little bit off there and a little bit off there, eventually it's gonna come to a little bit off everything, isn't it?
Yeah, and it's really, how much do you really save across a real account? Is it a few pounds?
And is the effort in the saving of the cables, Gordon, or is the effort and money in lifting the floorboards, chasing the walls and connecting the accessory on the end? Is there that much to be saved by maybe this ugly cable?
Yeah, and the kind of tip, what we found through dealing with now multiple fake and substandard cables, there's a feel to the cable, isn't
there?
I mean, it sounds strange that we're even saying this, but there's a kind of, some of these cables just feel a little bit odd.
They do.
If you're used to working with a particular type of cable, you get used to what that feels like. It's spotting that subtle difference that says, hold on, this isn't quite what it should be. You know, interestingly, our substandard cable has Basec on the side.
Okay, to stop you there. Yep. If you're going to take a little bit off the size, a little bit off the insulation, a little bit off the length, and not maybe put as much French chalk in, couldn't you just put Basec on it anyhow?
Yeah, and you could, and there's absolutely no easy way to tell where that cable's come from, so there's no markings on the reel.
Okay.
You know, I like to know there's a brand, and if there is a problem, and everyone has problems from time to time, there is somebody you can actually get in touch with to raise a concern, or you know, see what the, if this is really the cable, because obviously I suppose people could even fake the marking on the cable.
Yeah. Doncaster actually put Doncaster on their cable. We've got no name on this one, have we?
No, it's marked up by the person that distributed it, and I'm told that the you can trace the manufacturer by another secret number on there that can change from batch to batch. So you might buy from a distributor 1 month, and it's from a certain factory, and that flops to another factory another month. So you might think, oh yeah, that cable's good, but then you buy it another month and then suddenly that cable's not so good.
And if you're proud of it, you put your name on it and it's a British cable, and that Doncaster cable was the one that we used in this against this, what we're calling the ugly cable. So we looked at a fake cable today, didn't we? One that was pretending to be copper, but was actually aluminium. We looked at the ugly cable. So I suppose this would be the Doncaster cable and the flex that we used, the good. So we've had the good, the bad, and the ugly. Before he goes there, I'm going to move on quickly. We're always interested in your comments. Have you come across a cable that's really difficult to strip? And what painful experiences did you have on doing that on the installation? Leave those comments below. Have you got any cables you'd like us to have a look at? Again, reach out to us in the normal ways on social media and perhaps we could have a look at those cables. We're always interested in your thoughts, so please leave them below.